my pleasure to introduce Dave Haggerty. He gave me a whole list of things that he wants me to talk about, but I'm not going to do it. Everybody knows Dave. He's been a treasurer secretary for a good many years, and we miss him at that job. He's been married for 56 years, originally from Oswego, New York. I don't know exactly where that is.
Do you?
I went to Cornell.
Oh, well, that's right.
Been in Rotary for 39 years of perfect attendance. He joined in 78. Let's welcome Dave as here what he has to say.
Well, I have a few notes.
We'll be here a while.
So settle in, take your shoes off and get comfortable, and we'll talk about David. David was born on Easter Monday. That's why I love ham. I was the second child of a family of six children. Grew up in Oswego, New York. Lovely place to be away from in the winter. As a matter of fact, when I was away at college, came home one weekend in 1958, and it was snowing on Friday night when I came home. Snowed like unbelievable all day Friday night, all day Saturday, all day Sunday, all day Monday, all day Tuesday, and on Wednesday we went out our second story windows. Needless to say, I didn't get back to school for about 2 weeks, and did a lot of shoveling, and it was very hard to shovel because you couldn't get it up over the banks high enough, and the cars had bamboo poles on the front of the car with a flag on it, so when you came to an intersection, you could see there's something coming. Luckily, they don't have too many snowstorms like that, but they do have one every 4 or 5 years. Anyway, I am a dual military veteran. When I went to college, I went to a land-grant college, St. Bonaventure University, that had mandatory ROTC. So I was in the Army ROTC for 2 years, which was mandatory, but at the same time, I was the Navy Reserve and attending meetings, and so I've got more than you. I've got dual military services. When I grew up as one of six, we all had to do certain jobs. We got no allowance. We had jobs, but no allowance. We were just expected to do things. And in order to get money, I used to go and pick up soda bottles and bring them back for 2 cents, or deliver newspapers. I had a huge paper route. On Sunday, they dropped my papers off in six locations. There were so many. And that was a source of income. Then my next job was working in the pharmacy, and I was a delivery person. And I remember the owner used to have me do the deliveries with his brand new Buick car. And the third delivery, I got rear-ended. Somebody smacked into the back of the car, and he was so devastated because that was his wonderful car. It was a 1955 Buick. And so I'm dating myself now. I went on from that to go to college, came out, and met my wife on a blind date. A friend of mine arranged a blind date for me with a gal that was in class with him at Oswego State University, and we went out, and our blind date was to go to the Diary of Anne Frank movie. Great start.
Yeah.
The next morning I said to my best friend, I said, "She's really neat. I'm going to marry her." And 2 years later, we got married and started our own family. I have a son. I have a daughter, Colleen, who's a gifted and talented teacher in Huntsville, Alabama. She has three children and 1.5 grandchildren. And the next grandchild is gonna be born on my birthday, and it's supposed to be a boy, so you know what the name better be. My son Patrick went to Johns Hopkins on a free ride. Merck Drug paid for him to go to Johns Hopkins, and he's a department chairman of the School of Public Health at the University of Washington, and didn't want to go to work for me. He said, "Dad, you work too hard, so I'm gonna do something else," after I had offered him a job. And he's widely publicized, or widely published, he's got you beat hands down. If you Google him, you get about 4,800 hits. He's highly regarded, he's all over the world, as a matter of fact, talking on his topic. He invented a formula for biostatistics that I said to him, "Patrick, tell Dad really what it says. I mean, you wrote a book on it, but I'm not gonna read that book because it's too complex. I don't think I'd understand it." He said, "Well, Dad, if you shoot something to the moon and use my formula to guide it, you might come within a mile closer than you would with previous studies." So he's narrowed things down.
That's clear.
Yes,
that's
clear. Yeah, it's very clear. Growing up, I went through all the things with kids. My daughter was a horseback rider. I got thrown many times in shows, and unfortunately, many of those times, Grandma, my mother-in-law, was there with her, just so scared that she's going to get hurt. My son was through soccer and hockey and Little League. And then my daughter Colleen went to St. Lawrence University, where she met her husband. And my son Patrick went to Cornell. And after his first year, I brought him home. He got grabbed by the Moonies, and he was about ready to go and live on a farm with the Moonies. And I said, "Patrick, I'll come down and pick you up, and pick up your stuff, and you can go on." So after his last class that spring, I got there early, went to his room, put everything in my car. When he got out of class, I grabbed him and put him in the car and took him home. And I had a friend of mine who had a garbage truck, and I got Patrick a job on the garbage truck, which wore him out, and he became sensible again. And he then went back to Cornell.
US 41 cleanup.
Yes. He then went back to Cornell and made the dean's list the rest of the way through, and then went and got his master's, and then he went and got his doctorate at Johns Hopkins. And his doctorate at Johns Hopkins he got from Merck Drug, which they paid his full way. So I was very proud of him. I still am very proud of him because he's a great person. I started my career in the insurance business as a claims adjuster. My first big trip was to go to St. Louis, Missouri after a hailstorm and settle claims. And I probably did 500 or 600 of them. I was there for 4 months. And it's amazing how hail will beat houses apart, and aluminum siding and shutters and windows and cars. And while I was there, I saw my first tornado. I woke up one morning at the motel that we were staying at and went out to go to breakfast, and you could see a tornado coming right down, and it came within about a mile of us. So lo and behold, 4 or 5 days later, I was where the tornado hit, and adjusting claims there. And it was amazing. You could see tulips growing next to a house that was missing. It was so concentrated where the wind would do damage. My next assignment was Betsy, which is a hurricane that hit here in Florida, and I came to Miami and was assigned claims in Key West. And the bridge at Isle of Dora was out because a barge had broken loose during the hurricane. So I flew to Key West, and when I landed, it was kind of scary because there were all these anti-aircraft guns on the side of the runway, because that was right around the Cuban crisis. And a lot of military there. I had a lot of claims there. The biggest claim that I had handled there, I had a claim file that was a notice of loss. I got hold of the finance company and got a manifest of all the mobile homes that were on the site that were for sale. And I got a picture that I paid $100 to a UP photographer who had taken from a motel, showing all this mobile home trailer sales with the trailers in it, and then they were gone. They all got washed away, washed out to sea. And I paid $1.7 million on that claim. So that was my really first bite into Florida. And I kept on saying to my wife that sometime we're gonna go back to Florida. And she kept on saying, no, we're not, no, we're not. Well, when we got down to retirement time, this is where we came. We came back, and it's funny. My parents and her mother both lived in Bradenton after they retired. And I said, we both said we would never go back to Sarasota. And we traveled all around the state of Florida. We looked at housing from Jacksonville down to Miami and up the West Coast, and ended up right here in Sarasota. And I'm happy we did. During my career, I started again with CNA Insurance, and one Friday night in late June, we were just getting ready to go on vacation, and got a phone call. Be in Albany, New York tomorrow morning. We have a major claim. A propane truck had exploded in a town on the level of the town. Little town in eastern New York. So I went there and ended up being transferred there permanently. We paid all the claims that we could. We had $25 million in policy limits. When the limits were getting to be exhausted, we said, wait a second, we've got to find somebody else to help pay these claims. Why did this happen? So we had the trailer and truck towed to Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute to a warehouse, and we had some engineers analyze and find out what happened. And lo and behold, they found that when the trailer was manufactured to haul propane, protocol is that on the end and in the front, it's supposed to be a butt weld, where it's one over the top of the other. Well, when they did it, they did a weld like this. So the stress of the truck going through roads over a period of time apparently cracked it loose. And we can only surmise that the truck backfired as it got to the bottom of the hill. And propane is heavy, so it would have gone down, and that's what caused the explosion. I had one claim on that. It was one of the hardest claims I've ever had to handle. There was a little church that was down to about 10 members, but they had a fantastic organ, so we've been told, that had been made in Germany, shipped to Albany, New York, and then carried on people's backs and horses to this little church about 100 years prior. How do you go to find a value on something like that? I went to the Smithsonian Institute, and lo and behold, I got somebody who knew what I was talking about. And he gave me a value, and I was just about ready to settle the claim when we were running out of limits. So that was eventually settled for $250,000 for that organ, because of its that historical value. Let me go on. I adjusted claims, became a claims manager, and one of the agencies that sold a lot of policies for us was a firm called Rose and Kiernan. And I got to know the president of that agency, Peter Kiernan, who was a very dynamic person. He became chairman of the board of State Bank of Albany. And when he did that, because of the laws, he had to divest himself of the insurance agency. So he convinced me to go to work for him, and he sold the agency to the employees. There were 17 of us. I became a salesman, which I thought I could never sell, but it was like falling off a log. I started off selling homeowners insurance, auto insurance to individuals, and I could use an example of why they needed this because of claims that I'd handled. And even flood insurance that some people don't have that should buy. It's cheap, it's a good investment. Anyway, I became a very successful salesman. I then began selling commercial insurance. And again, from handling claims, I was able to give examples, and I insured Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, I insured State University of New York at Albany, I insured Albany Medical Center, I insured a lot of institutional, Union College. And it's funny, once you get into a network of business managers, they will always refer you. If you do a good job, they will refer you to somebody else. So I didn't do any calling anymore. People would call me and said, come. I then became vice president of sales. Then I became president. And after growing the agency under my presidency, we went from 17 to 122 employees. We covered most of upstate New York and into Connecticut. Did a lot of business in New York City out of Albany. One of my proudest moments was when I went with a young salesman. He got an appointment with Pepsi-Cola in Purchase, New York. And I went with him, and we came home with handling the insurance for Pepsi-Cola. And Hubline, which was another entity that they had. I hired a trainer for our salespeople because we're doing a lot of quoting work, and the salesmen were just trying to write business because their livelihood depended on it. And I met a fellow at a round table of an organization they belong to called Albany Executives. And he had a program called Sandler Sales Method. And I said, He explained it to me. I hired him. I hired him as our trainer. Took all our salesmen up to the Otisaga Hotel in Cooperstown, New York. And we went for a weekend and we retrained them into sales. They no longer became salespeople. They became people who would solve problems. They would talk to someone, and if that business owner was happy and his brother-in-law handled the insurance, we'd say, thank you, here's our card, here's a rose, so you might remember us. And when you're dissatisfied, give us a call. Well, about 10 months later, we started to get some great sales, which really grew the agency. By now I'm getting ready to retire. So I had already hired my successor, and with him, he brought some people, and we became one of the top 500 agencies in the United States with 380 employees. So I retired and decided to move to Florida because my wife liked Florida better than Arizona. She said Arizona was too beige. We came to Florida, and I went around and looked at multiple Rotary clubs around here, and I came back to this club. I thought this club was the best one to join up with. So I think I joined up here in 2000, maybe 2001, and became the secretary after so many years, and did that job for 12 years. I'm happy to say that two of the best presidents that I dealt with are here today. Andy and Stan. They were taskmasters. But they had a good vision, and they followed through and did what they originally said they were going to do. And I think we hit great growth in the club under both their leaderships. I decided when I retired I was going to become a great golfer. Guess what? The best golfer was probably used to sit right there. And Stan is probably second best. And I got bored. And I ran into an old friend of mine in 2004. Charlie had just come through and he said, "Dave, can you help me? We got so many claims, we don't know what we're doing. Can you just come in for a few weeks?" Well, I'm still there. And when I was adjusting claims for CNA, I was really handling commercial insurance. And after all those claims from the hurricane were settled, he said, "Well, could you work part-time a couple days a week helping us out with liability claims?" Well, a couple days went to 3 days, then to 4 days, and I'm still there, still having fun. Liability claims are fun as far as I'm concerned. There's so many things about it. Dealing with attorneys sometimes is difficult. But I'm not pointing at you, Gary. Gary, I think, would be a realistic attorney to deal with. I have others, and I brought along one that is probably the worst case of greed that I've ever seen. I still have. This is a claim that happened in 2012. It's still not concluded. A family in Pinellas County, the father died. The father lived with a mother and one son, and had another son. The father died, and the mother asked the two sons to come to the house to arrange the father's funeral the next day, in a couple days. Well, the one son lived in this other half of the duplex where the mother lived. And the mother said to the other son, "Would you go get Tom?" Well, these two brothers never got along good, and the brother went to get Tom, opened the door, 9 bullets in his stomach. He survived. He was air-evac'd to the hospital, did survive, spent 72 days in the hospital, and came out of the hospital and wanted to bring a claim against his mother for not warning him that his brother had a gun. That is probably the most far-fetched attorney claim that I can think of.
That's right.
We denied it. We denied coverage under the policy because the policy terms didn't provide coverage for a incident like that, because that was not an accident. Litigation started. We denied it again. We denied coverage again. This is only a $300,000 policy. You'd think that they're looking for $1 million. But we are now waiting for a hearing in federal court in Orlando in 2 weeks, declaring that our policy will not respond or provide any coverage to the mother for the incident. I've learned an awful lot about humanity, and sometimes it's getting worse and worse. And that's probably the worst example that I've ever seen of greed of that family. I did, in my career, spend a lot of time in giving back to others. I was on the vice chairman of the planning board of the town that I lived in, and one of the first people that I dealt with on a major project was Nate Benderson, who is now down here. Nate was from Buffalo, New York. He had bought a huge shopping center that was in kind of disrepair in Niskayuna, New York, and wanted to tear it down and build a new shopping center, but not as a building, as multiple buildings, multiple outbuildings. And we thought, who's going to do that in the wintertime in upstate New York? It was very successful and still is. And Nate was a pleasure to deal with. Anything he asked, no problem, we'll do it, we'll do it. And you can see why he was so successful, not only in upstate New York where he was, but when he came down here. And his son Randy, who I've dealt with also, is just like his father. I was on the board of a theater, Summerstock Theater in Schenectady. I was president of several business organizations as I went through business. I was on the board of the Red Cross in Albany for 10 years. And the last couple of years I was in charge of fundraising. And we were able to do enough fundraising and build a new building. So I must have done a pretty good job. When I retired, the word apparently spread because I got a call from the executive director down here to come to the board. And ended up being treasurer of the board of Red Cross here in town, and retired again. So I've had a lot of fun in life. I continue to have fun at work. I know that I should slow down and quit one of these days, but it's hard to put a fire dog out, fire hose dog out to pasture.
Yes.
Keep going.
So that's about the end of my story.
Awesome.
Just a opportunity for a question.
Good.
Okay. Now here is mine. Can you just tell us a little bit more about your impressions of Rotary and its future, please?
Rotary has changed since I've been here. When we first started, our little club was Albany Airport Rotary. We met at the airport. We were a new club in 1977. We had the first female in the Albany area in our club. She was an attorney, and we were still stodgy. Even though we were a breakfast club just like here, we were still stodgy. I've made up in many clubs all over the world, as a matter of fact. And I can only say that they were mostly stodgy, but they have now changed. I think that with more women and more openness in the clubs, there's been a lot of growth. I know we've seen some ebbs of membership. I think our membership worldwide is on the upswing now. I think there's a lot of people that want to do good for their fellow man and are joining Rotary to do service and do good for others. I think that'll continue.
Excellent. And on behalf of all of us, to the guest speaker for the day, a coffee man.
Thank you.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Yeah, you can pull the, you know what to do.
That's mine.
We only have 14 cards left.
Oh,
14.
There's $7 in today's drawing.
And you go,
here are the tickets. We're going to shake them up.
Just leave to pick it up. Okay, sir.
That's my winning ticket. 946.
So close.
Dapper Jack wins it all. Thank you, everyone, and thanks, Dave, for a great talk, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, what about the joke?